I found employment the third day after my arrival and stowing a sloop with a load of oil. It was new, dirty, and hard work for me, but I went at it with a glad heart and a willing hand. It was a happy moment, the rapture of which can be understood only by those who have been slaves. It was the first work, the reward of which was to be entirely my own. There was no master standing ready the moment I earned the money to rob me of it. I worked that day with a pleasure I had never before experienced. I was at work for myself and a newly married wife. It was to me the starting point of a new existence. I had been living 4 or 5 months in New Bedford when there came a young man to me with a copy of the Liberator, the paper edited by William Lloyd Garrison, and asked me to subscribe to it. I told him I had just escaped from slavery and was, of course, very poor and had no money then to pay for it. He was very willing to take me as a subscriber notwithstanding, and I read the paper from week to week. It soon took a place in my heart second only to the Bible. It detested slavery and made no truce with traffickers in the bodies and souls of men. It preached human brotherhood. It denounced oppression, and with all the solemnity of "Thus saith the Lord," demanded the complete emancipation of my race. The paper became my meat and my drink. My soul was set on fire. Its sympathy for my brethren in bonds, its scathing denunciations of slaveholders, and its powerful attacks upon the upholders of the institution sent a thrill of joy through my soul, such as I had never felt before. All the anti-slavery meetings held in New Bedford, I promptly attended, my heart bounding at every true utterance against the slave system and every rebuke of its friends and supporters. In the summer of 1841, a grand anti-slavery convention was held in Nantucket under the auspices of Mr. Garrison and his friends. I determined on attending the meeting, though I had no thought of taking any part in any of its proceedings. But once there, I felt strongly moved to speak, and though I trembled in every limb, I spoke a few moments, describing my life as a slave. At the close of this great meeting, I was approached by Mr. John A. Collins, then the general agent of the Massachusetts Anti-Slavery Society, and urged to become an agent of that society and publicly advocate its principles. I was reluctant to accept the position. I had not been quite 3 years from slavery and was honestly distrustful of my ability. Besides, publicity might discover me to my master. But Mr. Collins was not to be refused, and I finally consented to go out for 3 months. I traveled in the company of white abolitionists and lectured to large meetings. Many came, no doubt from curiosity, to hear what a Negro could say in his own cause. I was generally introduced as a chattel, a thing, a piece of Southern property, the chairman assuring the audience that it could speak. As a fugitive slave lecturer, I faced many hostilities. My treatment in the use of public conveyances was extremely rough. On the railroads, there was a mean, dirty, and uncomfortable car set apart for Negro travelers called the Jim Crow car. Regarding this as the fruit of slaveholding prejudice and being determined to fight the spirit of slavery wherever I might find it, I resolved to avoid this car, though it sometimes required some courage to do so. I sometimes was soundly beaten by conductors and brakemen. At several of our meetings, my fellow abolitionists and I were mobbed, and several of us had our good clothes spoiled by evil-smelling eggs. On one occasion, we had barely begun to speak when a mob of about 60 of the roughest characters I had ever looked upon ordered us through its leader to be silent, threatening us if we were not with violence. We attempted to dissuade them, but they had not come to parley, but to fight, and were well armed. They tore down the platform on which we stood and assaulted us. Undertaking to fight my way through the crowd with a stick which I caught up in the melee, I attracted the fury of the mob, which laid me prostrate on the ground under a torrent of blows. Leaving me thus, with my right hand broken and in a state of unconsciousness, the mobocrats hastily mounted their horses and rode off. I was soon raised up and nursed and bandaged. But as the bones broken were not properly set, my hand has never recovered its natural strength and dexterity. During the first 3 or 4 months of my work as an anti-slavery agent, my speeches were almost exclusively made up of narrations of my own personal experience as a slave. "Let us have the facts," said the people. But I was now reading and thinking. New views of the subject were being presented to my mind. It did not entirely satisfy me to narrate wrongs. I felt like denouncing them. I could not always curb my moral indignation for the perpetrators of slaveholding villainy long enough for a circumstantial statement of the facts, which I felt almost sure everybody knew. "People won't believe you ever were a slave, Frederick, if you keep on this way," my friends told me. "It is not best that you seem too learned." These friends were not altogether wrong in their advice. And still I must speak just the word that seemed to me to be the word to be spoken by me. At last, the apprehended trouble came. People doubted if I had ever been a slave. They said I did not talk like a slave, look like a slave, or act like a slave, and that they believed I had never been south of Mason and Dixon's line. I decided to write out the leading facts connected with my experience in slavery, giving names of persons, places, and dates, thus putting it in the power of any who doubted to ascertain the truth or falsehood of my story. This book, entitled Narrative of the Life of Frederick Douglass, an American Slave, was published in Boston in 1845. William Lloyd Garrison wrote the preface to my book.